Good afternoon. If you can please sit down, because we have a short period of time and want to try to use it all. So it was with great pleasure that I'm hosting here, in name of the Stigler Center, two very distinguished panelists. And I will not spend too much time introducing them, because otherwise there's so many titles that most of the time would go by sort of introducing them. But let me say just two words. One, Joe Stiglitz is not only a Nobel Prize winner, these days in Chicago is not a distinguished feature, there are so many, but also one of the most prolific and creative economists of the 20th and 21st century. So it's a real pleasure to have him here. Now, he's one of the few, actually, Nobel Prize in Economics who have no connection with the University of Chicago, except for the fact that his mother is a graduate from the University of Chicago. And he's actually was born in Gary, Indiana, a very sort of pleasant town. Markus Brunnermeier is a rising star in the economic profession, and again, he has not a connection with Chicago, except the fact that we would like very much to be here. He's one of the few financial economists who is not in Chicago, and I wish he were in Chicago. So with much further ado, I would like to actually start the panel. I want to start with a very simple but important question, since both of them are super talented and super prolific authors, but they work in a lot of topics. Why did you choose to dedicate the time to write a book on a topic like the euro? So, Joe, why don't you start and say why you thought you're not even European? Why do you care?
Yeah, and it's a good question, because a natural question is, doesn't America have enough problems of its own? You don't have to go across the seas to well, from an economic point of view, the euro is really interesting. You know, in economics, we don't have very many experiments. And this is a natural experiment. Nobody in the right mind would have done it, but they did it. And now we get to see what happened. And so it poses just a huge number of interesting problems. It's also related to a number of other issues that I've been interested in. It's a kind of globalization. Globalization is just a economic integration of countries of the world. This was a attempt at a very tight form of economic integration in one part of the world, sharing a common currency. And when it started, I was very pessimistic about it. Bob Mundell, who had taught at the University of Chicago, had written a famous paper about what were the conditions required for a single currency to work. And it was very clear that Europe didn't satisfy those. It was very clear that it was a political project, not an economic one. And it was the hope that this kind of economic integration, a single currency, would push on, would motivate stronger the political project, the European project of closer political integration. But while it was a political project, the politics weren't strong enough to create the institutions that would make it work. So there was a hope that they would, over time, finish the construction. And nothing very much happened until 2010. It was started in 1992, it went really in Maastricht Convention, and then it began in 1999, and the currency was introduced in 2002. And it wasn't that long after that the 2008 crisis happened. And it was, you might say, bad luck. If there hadn't been any crisis, things might have gone on longer before the weaknesses that were I think inevitable would have shown up. But beginning in 2010, there were some efforts to address the problems, but in my mind, much too little, and typically too late. I think what I've learned in studying the euro was that Bob Mundell, as forceful as analysis was, really underestimated what was required to make a single currency work, because he had a very simple model of the economy based basically on a perfect markets and what would happen with, you know, reasonably well-functioning markets. And I think he underestimated, for instance, just to give you one example that I talk about a lot, the role of the government in backing the banking system and the consequences of not having common deposit insurance, common banking resolution. Those kind of institutional details were left out of the kind of analysis that was common at the time. And now we recognize that those actually were very, very important. And so one of the, what I think is interesting ideas that come out in this book is that while the hope of the founders of the euro was that they, by creating the euro, it would lead the countries to get closer and closer together, and that would provide the basis of more political solidarity. In fact, it's led to divergence. So they hoped, and what I try to explain in the book is why it was really part of the structure of the eurozone as it was created in 1992 that almost inevitably led to this divergence where the rich got richer and the poor got poorer. I don't know, I can go on, but you...
So the bottom line, but the motivation of the book is to say what? That we're doomed, that Europe is doomed, that the euro is doomed, or is there hope?
There's always hope, but it's really, let me put it this way. I was very torn because I really think that the idea of the European project was very important, this kind of political bringing together the countries of Europe. I think in many areas, Europe has been really a beacon for human rights, for climate change, and even more so after the last election. So having a working Europe is really important, not only for Europe, but I think for the world. What I worry about is that because of this very flawed currency arrangement, it won't be able to fulfill those roles. So in a way, the bottom line of the book is that there either has to be more Europe, completing the institutions that are required to make a single currency work, or less Europe, an amicable divorce, introducing some more flexibility. If you ask me which direction, I'm not very hopeful about the first. So the bottom line is, in a sense, that it may be necessary to abandon the euro to save the European project. That money is just money. It's not very important. Even though you are in the business school, you should understand that money is not important. It's not. It won't make you happy. And the pursuit, unbridled pursuit of money, will make you very unhappy. So and a currency is only a currency, and currency arrangements come and go. There's a lot of irrational emotional attachment to this particular, these little pieces, these little currencies. So my view is that the best thing would be to fix it, but if you can't fix it, just move on.
Okay, so Markus, just think this was saying, and I think was right in saying that the creation of the euro and the institutional structure was done by macroeconomists that really did not think very much about banking and about financial stability and et cetera, very much more oriented toward inflation, et cetera. Now, you have the benefits of not being one of those. You actually study a lot the friction in the banking sector, et cetera, but you seem to be much more optimistic in your book and much more optimistic about the future of the euro. So why did you write your book and what are your hopes?
Yeah, so I'm more optimistic, and I agree with the theme that actually financial stability was really underplayed and didn't play the role in the early 1990s or late 1980s. You know, this was before the Southeast Asia crisis where all the big spillovers happened, and this was not so prevalent in the people's minds.
And let me tell you, I think I want to stress this because most people don't fully perceive what we're doing here as academics. But this has a tremendous importance, especially when you do things wrong. Not necessarily when you do things right, but when you think things wrong. And the fact that the academic profession was so focused on one dimension and forgot the other had important consequences in the creation of the euro.
Yes. So that's what we try to outline in the book, very detailed. I mean, I think there's some overlap on this dimension. The other thing we emphasize very much is that even if you take this as given, and then we can fix that, there are different economic philosophies within Europe. And it's not only your interests matter, but also your ideas matter. So I made some little slides here. And I should say it's a joint work with Harold James and Jean-Pierre Landau. And you know, Jean-Pierre is French, I'm German, and Harold is British. So we came together and we realized how differently we think in terms of economic philosophy. And that's what we actually emphasize in the book, that you know, we come with very different philosophies, in particular between France and Germany, in more generally, you know, broader areas in the euro area.
I claim that there's even bigger difference with the British, but decide to leave.
Actually, in many banking-related things, France and British were thinking alike, but the British said, oh, you should do this big bazooka and all these things, but we don't pay in. It's essentially up to the Germans to give the guarantee. So if I just may jump into this. So the idea of the book was essentially to outline this difference in thinking and make it clear to policymakers how different the thinking is. And this is the first step to get some convergence down the road. Because they're very different economic philosophies, and there are many dimensions we can slice this apart. And we divided this up, you know, France and Germany, this Rhine divide, that's the river between France and Germany, dividing both countries. And there are four dimensions we can play along this line. The first one is essentially discretion versus rules, and everybody talks about discretion versus rules. But actually, the relationship is a little bit more subtle. From a French perspective, there's a lot of discretion in some dimensions, but in other dimensions, they have a straitjacket commitment. So they really commit on something, and that's why they need so much discretion in other dimensions. So that's the French perspective. While the Germans very much want an autonomous system and everything is guided by rules, a framework of rules ex ante rather than ex post interventionist. And when the French intervene, it's all these ad hoc measures. The Germans frown upon this as ad hoceries and all that. While the French say, well, that's a very, you know, active crisis management. We just deal with the current crisis. So if you have this framework where you have very much discretion in some dimensions and a lot of straitjacket commitments in other dimensions, then you know you have this particular difficulties. And let me just give you some examples where this straitjacket commitment comes in. So for example, the attitude not to default on debt is much more pronounced in France than in Germany. And you saw this when Germany was pushing for the debt restructuring of Greek debt, where the famous walk between Angela Merkel and President Sarkozy on the beach of Deauville, where it was the case, you know, the Germans pushed through, there would be some debt restructuring for the Greek debt and the private sector involvement. So that's one dimension where they differ very much. And the question is, can you commit that you don't default on your government bonds? And one way to commit it is you stuff it into your local banks. Because if you default on your government bonds, you bring your banking sector down, and with the banking sector, you bring the whole economy down. That's essentially a commitment device, and that's the one way to solve this commitment problem is to use your bank as a hostage. Okay, and that's comes in current regulatory framework, comes in, should there be some risk weights on sovereign debt? The French and the Italians, they all say, no, we need our banks to stuff our sovereign paper into the banks. Well, the Germans are pushing for risk weights and want to make banks as an insurer. So if something goes wrong, you can restructure the government and then the banks will still be viable. And there's a huge debate at the moment going on that you can see the difference. So in this dimension, the French are very much strictly committing to not defaulting, and it's very pronounced. Another dimension is in terms of currency pegs, and also the French are much more for a currency peg. They were actually pushing for the EMU much more strongly initially than Germany was pushing. The Germans were very reluctant to go into the EMU in the first place. And the French were actually also pushing not to have any exit rules from the EMU. They wanted to keep it very vague, and the argument is you straitjacket commit yourself to stick in, to be within the EMU in order to avoid any currency attacks or any attacks against the EMU in the first place. Well, the Germans are much more open for, you know, flexible exchange rates and all that. And that's, if you take this Mandel-Fleming dilemma triangle, which I've put on the slides here. The French perspective is on one side, they want autonomous monetary policy, like both, but then they want to have fixed exchange rates, and they're much more willing to give up the free capital movement, while the Germans are not willing to give up the free capital movement, but they're willing up to give the fixed exchange rate. So that's one dimension, that's the discussion versus rules, but it's more subtle because in certain dimensions, the French really commit themselves very forcefully to a particular one. The second dimension is what we describe in the book is the solidarity versus liability principle. If you go to German order liberalism and all this, it's all about the person in charge should be liable for it. There should be no solidarity. You cannot divorce the action, the guy who can do the action, from the liability. And that's very pronounced in the German liability principle. While the French have much more solidarity principle, fiscal union is very common. The Germans are always concerned about a fiscal union. It immediately translates into a transfer union. And it also came up in the Eurobond proposal. The French were always pushing for joint liability in the Eurobonds. The Germans resisted. Angela Merkel said, not in my lifetime there will be a Eurobond. Okay, she refused it totally. The third dimension is on liquidity versus solvency. Whenever there's a financing problem, the Germans say it's a solvency problem. And if you just throw good money after bad, the net present value is negative, you have to restructure, you have to do something. While the French say, oh, it might be a liquidity problem, just show your big bazooka, and you know, just you don't have to put any money in and it will help and get solve everything. And that's in economic language just a multiple equilibrium story. It's a classic liquidity problem with a bad and a good equilibrium. And you don't have to put any single euro in, and it will help you to survive the whole thing. Just show your strength that you have enough money to solve it. That's one, and actually, if you look at the London speech in the summer of 2012, that's what happened. Oh, Mario Draghi said that we do whatever it takes, and all the yields came down, and he didn't spend a single euro on it. So the program, the OMT, which he implemented, didn't really cost any single euro, but nevertheless, the whole markets and everything stabilized. So this was, in a sense, a multiple equilibrium and liquidity problem. But there are also multiple equilibrium problems or other liquidity problems which are not multiple equilibria. They are much more amplification problems. So it's, you know, the demand curve is not inverted S-shaped, but it's more script S, like an integral and inverted script like on the slides. In these circumstances, you have to put some money in and then it helps. You put 1 euro in and get 10 euros of benefit. You would still call this a liquidity problem because it pays off and the net present value is positive. But the question is, what is the net present value? What is the net? Is the present value of a bailout versus the present value of no bailout? And there is also huge disagreement. Whenever, you know, is this systemic and the cost of a bailout, you know, they might be costly, but not bailing out, the costs are much more dramatic. The French always say, yes, there will be huge systemic implications. We have to bail out. The Germans said, no, we don't have to bail out. The cost of not bailing out, the systemic effects are not so dramatic. The spillover effects are not so dramatic. And the classic case where this played out was Cyprus in the spring of 2013. That's another one of these watershed moments where the Germans said, no, if Cyprus is systemic, then everything is systemic and we can forget our no bailout rule. So we have to stand our grounds and have to move away from this bailing out to more to a bail-in philosophy. Remember, in Cyprus, most of the banks, they were holding money from Russian oligarchs, black money, and the Germans refused to use European taxpayers' money to bail out Russian oligarchs, and they were really strict on it. And that actually shifted the whole entity. Emphasis was away from bailout to more bail-in. That's why the new regime was established, this bail-in regime, which is now Italy is suffering from.
I find it fascinating your sort of view of the different philosophy and the importance of history and tradition and all this. But let me play for a second the devil's advocate. Because if you are a traditional economist who doesn't believe in culture and all this stuff, you say, wait a minute, the Germans are doing or advocating. I do believe, but I have to play sort of the moderator role. So, say the Germans are enhancing their interest, and the French the same. This is the French are in favor of a transfer union because they're going to benefit from the transfer. They're in favor of bailing out Greece because their banks are heavily dependent on that they do in Greece and so on and so forth. And the Germans are on the other side of that equation. So tell me an example in which the rules are binding for the Germans. So something that is against the German interest, but they push it because it's in their philosophy to do that.
Can I just add one aspect to that? Because in 2010, when Greek crisis first emerged, at that point, Germany was quite amenable to a bailout because it was the German and French banks that were being bailed out. And it was only after the German and French banks were put that Germany became more religious on these matters.
I wouldn't say it this way. No, I should say, you know, the interests still play a role, but the way you look at the interests is through the lens of the ideas you have. But indeed, it is the case. If you look at 2010, mm-hmm. The interests of France and Germany pretty much were aligned. Mm-hmm. And I would say if there is a huge transfer union, it will come out of France. Now, it can't be just Germany is bearing all the burden. I think France and Germany are aligned in many dimensions if something goes wrong. Of course, Germany will pay the bigger lion's share, but France still has to pay that. I don't think they will get transfers.
No, I understand, but I'm more interested in the case in which sort of Germany goes against its economic interests because of its philosophy.
So to some extent, of course, the public, private sector involvement of the Greek debt was too slow to be implemented. Mm-hmm. But the Germans pushed already early on, but it was resisted by the French. Even though the position was very similar, France and Germany, both their banks had huge exposure to Greek debt. And then Germany in the summer of 2010 was really trying hard to change the stability and growth pact and put more rules into the place. And when this didn't go anywhere, then Germany said, we need market discipline. And they really pushed for private sector involvement. It took months for this to implement. And it was agreed upon in October 2010. But then it took, you know, more than a year to really do the haircut and the restructuring. But you can see that, you know, both have exactly the same interest. They both have exposure to the debt. They should have the same interest, but one was pushing and the other one was not.
Well, when in 2008 the Landesbank were broken, there wasn't any bail-in or any sort of decider that you have to bear responsibility. There was a bailout paid by the German taxpayer.
Yes, yeah, so Germany learned its lesson from that. So if there will be another one, they would not do it.
So you think the Deutsche Bank is not going to be bailed out?
I think it's highly unlikely. I think there will be probably a private arrangement and there will, you know, I don't think taxpayer will be drawn into that. It would be politically infeasible.
When you say taxpayer, I mean, maybe we're getting off, but the taxpayer might not be drawn into it in an obvious way, but it could be a bailout through a bank that the government owns substantial fractions of, and therefore the taxpayers in a less transparent way would be bearing significant costs.
So I wouldn't rule out arrangement like this, or in particular there's some industry consortium coming together and help out. No, that's, I mean, but then the government would be like the LTCM case where the government would take more an organizing role or coordinating role, but it would not use taxpayers' money. I think that's...
Joe, your book is quite different from Markus' book. What do you like the most and what do you like the least of his book?
Actually, Markus and I agree on a number of these points. That in fact, one of the things that I argue very strongly is that ideas matter, that it's not just interest, that ideas help shape, and it's particularly ideas about what would make an economy work were very influential in this construction of the euro in 1992. And as you mentioned, if it had been done now in 1998 after the East Asian crisis, after the global financial crisis, I think the rules would have been written in a very different way. There would not have been the as blind a faith that markets would take care of most of the things so long as governments kept deficits and debt low and as long as inflation was kept low. I think that I also agree very strongly with Markus that sometimes these ideas do differ culturally across countries and can't easily be explained other than by maybe by history or by culture. For instance, I would have thought that after all the experiences of the East Asia crisis and they would have come to the view that deficit keeping the euro framework said that if countries only kept their deficits low below 3% and debt low below 60%, and the economy would work well. There was no economic studies that supported this. There was a study that Rogoff said that if debt got over 80 or 90%, things went bad. But then one of the triumphs of good graduate students, a graduate student discovered there's a spreadsheet mistake and that even that number, 80 or 90%, had no validity to it. So, and you look at the history of even Europe, Spain and Ireland had crises and they had a surplus before the crisis. They had very low debt to GDP ratio. So you would have thought from all that, you would have said having low deficits and debt are not, you know, maybe good things to have, but they're not critical. And yet, after the euro crisis began, Germany basically doubled down, at least in my on this law theory, and said that's really what we have to pursue. So I think it does illustrate the important role of ideas. What I find difficult to understand from Markus is, you know, what Bob Mundell said in his article was that if countries are going to share a common currency, they have to be similar. And that was the whole idea of convergence, and they set up a system of divergence, so the countries now are much further apart. But I think what we've also learned is that these are political entities. There are decisions about discretion, about when to use discretion and when not. And there are very different, large differences in views about what makes for a good economy. And here Markus and I both agree strongly. That leaves me, though, with a very strong sense of pessimism. When I said that I'm not sure that you're going to be able to make this work, what I see is this huge economic divergence, which is larger today than it was in 1992. In 1992, there were large differences in beliefs, but the increasing disparity in the economy has, if anything, increased the disparity of beliefs. And so the conclusion that I get out of this is it's going to be even more difficult to make the euro work. And what I don't quite understand is Markus's optimism.
So Markus, why don't you tell us what is the source of your optimism? And also, it's your turn to say what you like and not like of Joe's book.
I mean, there's some similarity, I agree with that. So why are we more optimistic? I think one should also look what has happened since 2010. There are many measures put in place which were unimaginable before 2010. I think we can't just dismiss that nothing happened. I think there were many measures put in place. If you just look at the whole banking side, if you look at the single supervisory mechanism, so everything, all the big banks are regulated by the Europeans, makes a huge difference where the national interests, essentially what happened to the national regulators, that became defenders of their banks towards the Europeans. And now it's the big banks are regulated by the Europeans and you have much more control over this. It becomes much less problematic. If you look at the whole European integration process, it was always a process where you brought some sound institutional arrangement to all the countries. You know, some of these countries came out of dictatorship or came, you know, from some coup attempts and other things. Sorry for that. And so that's also what's still ongoing, and there's a lot of process going on. And if I'm optimistic, I think, first of all, I think you have to have some healthy optimism in a sense that you keep the whole project going. I think we are at the critical phase and it's dangerous to shoot it down. I think it would be really a huge step backwards. But the optimism comes essentially from the fact that so many steps were taken. Other dangers are on the corner. You know, we talked about Italy, the referendum coming up and many other things come up. Yes, there are huge challenges and things go wrong. But it is the case that it's helping and it's going moving forward, and there's some, you know, smart interventions which help this.
Can I make just a comment? I mean, one of my concerns is that halfway houses may be worse than either extreme. So some of the reforms, I mean, I think Mark is absolutely right. There have been some big steps, and is a bigger than anticipated. And when I've discussed this in Europe, for instance, with Joseph, who was the head of the finance ministers, you know, he says, you know, it took America, we passed our banking, a national banking law in 1863, and it took you a long time to get everything working, and it's still not working well. So just give us another 100 years or so. You know, the glass is, you know, maybe not half full or half empty, it's maybe 1% full, but it's still 99%. It's 99% empty, but it's still 1% full, and that gives us hope. But what worries me is that some of these halfway houses are actually worse than nothing. So, for instance, they've talked about a banking union, which is the kind of framework that took a long time in the United States to establish, which is common supervision, a common resolution when a bank goes and has a problem, how does it get resolved, who bails it out, in effect, and common deposit insurance. To prevent divergence of the Eurozone, the most important is common deposit insurance. And yet, the response of Germany is now, yes, we agree with the principle, but not yet. And sort of, you know, like virtue, what was St. Augustine said, deliver me from sin, but not yet. So that's sort of the...
I'm impressed by your sort of knowledge of the Catholic writers.
So that's the most important, to prevent the money flowing from the weak countries to the strong countries, and that plays a very big role in the divergence, because as money leaves the weak countries, the banks can't lend, and the weak countries get weaker, and the strong countries get stronger. And that's not in the short run horizon. But common supervision can actually be bad without common deposit insurance, because what happens then, important in any country's banking system is this issue of discretion that you were talking about. You talk about any central bank governor, and they will talk about the importance of forbearance and when to have forbearance and when not to. And when you have a systemic risk, it's very important to have forbearance. And if you don't have common deposit insurance and a common resolution, then having uniform rules without sensitivity to the situation of each country of where they need to have forbearance could actually make things worse.
Well, in your this is one thing that needs to change, and I agree with you. But in your book, you have such a long list of things that are required for the euro to work that at the end of the book, at least I came with a suspicion that it's impossible, because there are so many things, and the probability of all of them to take place, safe to say, is zero. So, suppose you are king of Europe for a day. What would you do if you were, say, what is the most important thing that you would pass to make the euro feasible?
Well, I think the two or three things are this.
You see, you give him king for a day, and you require two or three.
Okay. Well, you could group them around. So the banking union, with the most important provision being common deposit insurance. I think some form of euro bonds,
not Marcus, in Angela's lifetime. So.
But Markus has some interesting innovations about how to do this in a way that might allow Angela to sleep at night. I think if she were willing, it could be done. The real question is she willing? And you know, she could listen to him and say, "Okay, there's a framework of a safe euro bond." But I'm not sure she's willing. I think that fundamentally, what one needs is, if you're going to have this degree of monetary integration, a single currency, you have to have a greater degree, a little degree of fiscal commonality. You know, it doesn't have to be a same degree of fiscal integration in the United States, where two-thirds of expenditure are the federal government and one-third are the state and local. It could be the reverse. But the fraction of GDP that is spent by the central government, the federal Brussels, is about 1 or 2%, and a lot of that is on common agricultural policy. So you need,
which is bad.
So yeah, which is bad.
The only thing they do actually is something they be better not doing.
So and then you ask the question. What I begin, one of the chapters is, what enables America to share 50 diverse states to share a common currency, without having the kind of divergence and the instability? And another example that we have is that when the country goes into an economic recession, the cost of the higher level of unemployment in, say, California is borne by the country as a whole. So we have some risk sharing. We don't call it a transfer union. In fact, New York and California keep paying money to the southern states that vote the wrong way. We don't say we're not a transfer union. We sometimes think it, but we would never say it publicly. But the point is that there are lots of ways that we help mitigate the risk, particularly of cyclical fluctuations and economic divergence. And so I guess I would say you have to have some form of risk sharing of that kind if you're going to make it work.
Let me just add to this. So there is a lot of form of risk sharing already. We have the ESM. A lot of measures were taken where the European Stability Mechanism and all this was put in place, and huge transfers were made through the Target 2 systems behind the scene. So it's not that there's nothing happened. If you look at the sudden stop countries faced outside of the Eurozone, they also had huge capital inflows and there was a sudden stop, and they had to react much more sharply to that. So there is already some risk sharing going on. I think it's not fair to say, okay, there's no risk sharing going on in Europe as well. The other thing is what the Germans are very afraid of. The Germans put a lot of emphasis on political economy. You really have to understand the political economy situation. And what they don't want to end up with a transfer union, something like in Italy, where the North is supporting the South, and then it's not going well. And that's what they are afraid of. So what you will have is you have a productive core. The productive core, all the productive people move to the core, produce there, and then the periphery is supported by the core. That's not a vision in the long run how Europe should work. So you want to have an arrangement where all of Europe can be productive and do something. And a transfer union, risk sharing is fine, but if it goes in two ways, in good times for one region, it goes in one way, and good times for the other region, it goes in the other way. But the danger is really that it will be a transfer union in the long run. And that's actually, Italy in a sense is a warning example for
absolutely.
That.
But if you were the king for a day, what would you do?
So for a day, it's very short. So I think that
you can pass one measure.
No, one thing I think what we need in Europe is we need a more European identity. I thought a lot how to strengthen the European identity. And the other thing is probably I would put this, the ESPYs in place. I mean, it would solve not all the problems, but solve two problems. One is whenever you have a flight to safety, at the moment, the flight to safety into a safe haven asset goes across borders. I want to rechannel this, not to go across borders. And the other advantage is you switch off this diabolic loop or this doom loop or nexus between sovereign risk and banking risk. So these two problems it would solve. So how do the ESPYs work? The ESPYs work in the sense you have some special purpose vehicle and they buy up some sovereign bonds up to a certain level, and then they issue a senior bond and a junior bond. And whenever there's a restructuring in some country or not, then it will be the case that the junior bond will suffer from this, and the junior bond essentially protects the senior bond. So the senior bond is a safe asset and it's a European-wide asset. At the moment, it is the case that Germany has a monopoly on the safe asset. Whenever the crisis becomes more severe, then the flight to safety runs across borders out of the periphery into Germany, In this new framework, it would run from the European junior bond into the European senior bond. So it would be not cross-border, it would be from a European entity to another European entity. And it would also, if you don't allow the banks to hold the junior bonds, you can actually potentially restructure government's debt without bringing the banks into difficulties. So you switch off this diabolic loop. I mean, that's one of the things.
Speaking of diabolic loop, this Sunday there will be a referendum in Italy, and we don't know what the outcome would be, but people are afraid that the recapitalization of Monte Paschi, that somehow is connected with the referendum, and I want your opinion with that, might not go through. So what is your recipe? So suppose that they can't find the $5 billion in equity they are raising. You are the head of supervision, you are the head of the ECB. What will you do?
That's a tricky thing to do, and I don't want to cause some bank run or anything like that. But essentially, there is now a regulatory framework in Europe how to do things within the bail-in regime, and there are two exemptions. So there's one exemption: if you declare something a systemic event, you can still do a bailout. But there's also an exemption if a bank is seen in the last stress test, in the baseline stress test scenario, as being solvent, then actually you can only wipe out the shareholders and the junior bondholders, and then you do recapitalization subsequently. And that's essentially one option you can go, this Article 32 arrangement, where you actually wipe out the existing shareholders and the junior bondholders, and you do a hardship fund for retail investors who hold these junior bonds, so for some particular junior bondholders, and then you restructure the bank this way on the liability side. You don't close down the bank is still operating the same way, so the public will not notice much, and the deposits will not suffer from this either. It's essentially only the junior bondholder. The only thing you have to be careful on that what happened last fall is that some of the junior bondholders, they were tricked into buying this as being a safe asset, and they put all their retirement savings into this, and they will suffer some hardship from that. And so you need some extra cushion for these people.
What about you? Yeah, what would you do?
Well, I just want to highlight one of the policy dilemmas is this bail-in and how it has effects from decisions made in one case where to others. So the notion of bail-in is that depositors or others might lose their money. And in the case of Cyprus, there was even deposit insurance, and the question was, should you ignore that and bail them in? And the position that was taken, it was eventually reversed, but there was a decision taken at one point with that you would bail in the depositors. So they would suffer a loss. That to me was a really bad decision. And even if it were Russian plutocrats that were oligarchs that had deposits there. And the reason I worry about that is that, and the same thing effectively happened in Greece in a different form, because it sends a very strong signal. If you keep your money in the banks in one of these countries where there is the possibility of a problem, you may lose your money. So precautionary, what does a rational individual do? It takes the money out. So in a sense, Europe has made an incentive for a run against the banks. And the only way to stop that is to have a European-wide deposit insurance. So in a way, the policies that they pursued in Greece and in Cyprus have made it even more imperative quickly to have this kind of European-wide deposit insurance. And they haven't done that. And that's why, in some ways, I think things are worse today than they were when the crisis started in 2010.
Can I just add to this deposit insurance topic? So first, there are two components. One is Cyprus and one is deposit insurance in general. I think we both agree that deposit insurance and deposit insurance fund is negligibly small. It doesn't really make a big dent in anything. So it has to be the fiscal authority of the government to stand fully behind that.
Okay, that's of course, yeah.
And it is agreed in the rules that up to 100,000 euros, there is no bail-in. So there won't be any bail-in arrangement. What happened in Cyprus is a little bit more subtle in a sense that Cyprus had as a business model, they wanted to build up a banking sector and attract funds from Russian oligarchs and all that. And they didn't want to give up this business model and said, the problem was in the Cyprus banks was that most of their liabilities were deposits. There was no other stuff, junior bonds and senior bonds there. It was all deposits because they were afraid to be bailed in. So it was only deposits there. And the Cyprus government said, we don't want to actually bail in more than 10% or more than 9.9% of the big money depositors, because it would ruin our business model of building up this financial hub in Cyprus. Hence, the remaining point was then the smaller depositors will also suffer 6.75%. And this was a haggling back and forth on this all the time. And then the solution was found up to 100K, there was actually no bail-in, but beyond 100K, because essentially they're not really deposits. They're essentially just declared as deposits. These are bonds de facto, but you hold them as deposits in order to avoid the bail-in rule.
No, I understand Cyprus, but the Financial Times claimed in an article the other day that if the referendum get not approved, 8 Italian banks might get into trouble. And those in that situation, there is a serious risk of a bank run. And as you said, there is not real deposit insurance in Italy because the fund is too small and the capacity of the government to pay is very limited.
But you have this Article 32, you can immediately use it and then you just insure deposits.
With the Italian government backing, is not credible because we have 130% debt to GDP. So we need European backing that doesn't exist.
In times of crisis, there will be some European backing.
Okay, so we have to go through waterboarding in order to get that. That's sort of the strategy.
But otherwise, the Italian example also shows there's no way to clean up your banks on your own. You know, if the banks were to be cleaned up independently by the Italian authorities, then there could be guaranteed right away.
Article 32 also talk about systemic events. So if you have 8 banks going under in Italy, is that systemic or not?
Yes, so there are two. There's one is this, if the banks satisfy the solvency requirement, and there's another one, even if the banks are not in the baseline stress test scenario, not solvent.
Yeah, but that's systemic. Not the case, because all the banks in Italy pass the baseline scenario.
So you don't even need a systemic exemption.
No, if you don't want to bail in all the subordinated, there is a systemic exemption. And do you think that the crisis in Italy can be systemic or not? Can be defined systemic or not?
That's not up to me to decide.
I understand. If you were king for the day, would you think?
I think you understand now why Europe has a crisis. I think this is illustrates the difficulties and the rules and the uncertainty that is facing Italian depositors about whether it is systemic and what you can get a run. If there's not clarity, and if you don't know, you're not going to wait and find out how these decisions, whether it satisfies rule, I can't remember now, 50 or 47. So the point is that they've created an environment where there is this ambiguity and in which there is a significant risk of a run.
No, the only thing is a blanket guarantee by Germany will in the long run not solve it, because you have to fix some structural problems on the ground as well, some governance problems and other issues. Just saying, oh, Germany will guarantee everything, then everything will be smooth, but then we run into a bigger crisis down the road when Germany will be dragged down too. That doesn't help Europe, it might help for some short time period.
Okay, I would love to ask more questions, but I think I have to open up to the public that is eager to ask those questions. So there are two microphones over there and there. So if you can please go to the microphone and raise short questions. And can you go to the microphone?
Hi. A lot of the discussion has focused on fairly technical questions of banking policy and regulation. I'd like to ask a question more about the political economy underlying this divergence and the fact that we've seen a real emphasis on export-led growth in Northern Europe, which has, in a way, been taken as the example to follow for countries like Spain and Italy. And yet we've seen internal devaluation and the austerity measures that have been adopted really haven't been enough to turn Spain into Germany, which perhaps shouldn't be surprising given the different institutions there. So I wonder if internal devaluation has failed as a strategy, what's the prospect for a symmetrical adjustment in the core countries to expand domestic demand? And from a political economy perspective, one would expect that there are coalitions, there are constituencies within the northern countries who would be interested in such a policy, particularly German workers outside of the export-oriented industries. So do you think that that would be a more constructive growth strategy? And if so, what would the political constituency be for that?
Markus, what do you think?
Yes, so I agree. I mean, of course, you would like to, for example, would like to have higher wage growth rate in Germany, in the Netherlands, in the core, in order to stabilize the situation. And indeed, if you look at what the Bundesbank made some noises along these lines, in particular, the Dutch Central Bank made a lot of, you know, its communication policy was very much focused in affecting the wage bargaining within the country, in the core, in order to get more wage growth going in the core countries, or in particular here in the Netherlands, and also the Bundesbank did something. Of course, there's some issues there, but one option is essentially to help through strategic communication by the central bank to help the wage bargaining process or tilt them or nudge them in a particular way in order to get more wage growth going in the core countries and then alleviate some of the pressure. I should say also that, you know, the situation is improving. So the Spanish situation, they're growing nicely again. So Spain turned itself around. So it worked. The structural reforms worked and Spain turned around. Of course, they're back to the GDP level they started before the crisis, but they're back again. Ireland is phenomenally growing. So there are some success examples in Europe as well. One always focus only on Greece and some other not so well functioning examples. But they're actually where the structural reforms really worked and made a huge difference. One should keep this in mind. They're all totally ignored by the media. But
yep. So let me just say a couple of things. First of all, I mean, Ireland is fantastic. It's grown 26% in GDP last year. If you believe that, then I have a bridge in Brooklyn to sell you. The fact is it's based on tax avoidance and a business model that is robbing other countries. And it's not real GDP. You talk to people in Ireland, they don't feel the increase in their standards of living. The model of Germany of export-led growth is not a model that can work for the world. Just think about it. Net export of the world is what? Zero. As long as our trade with Mars remains limited. So the fact is that for every country that has an export, there is another country that is an import. And so those exports can be said to cause other countries' imports. Keynes worried about this, and he said, he gave a solution, that you ought to tax the surplus countries. And that would be a solution within the Eurozone. I don't think that that's likely. I haven't heard it discussed in a positive way. But your question you raised, I've given talks to the SPD, which is the left to center, and to the unions in Germany. And there is a lot of support, but it is still a small percentage of the voters. You know, they like the idea of raising wages, inflation, inflating the economy, and getting, you know, the wages in Germany at the bottom, incomes at the bottom are still, have not been doing very well. The bottom 30% have not been doing very well. So what is really needed is, I think, a policy. You know, they finally got a minimum wage, although this has something to do with the structure of labor markets. They finally got a minimum wage a couple years ago. In my mind, I very strongly agree that the policy of internal devaluation enforces the burden of adjustment on the deficit countries. And we know that there are asymmetries of adjustment, that lowering wages puts a lot more strain on the macroeconomy than raising wages, especially in countries where there are debts. Because when you lower wages, you increase the leverage
the effect of debt-GDP ratio. And so it actually exacerbates the economic downturn, and which is why it has been such an unsuccessful strategy. And finally, Spain, it is doing better on exports. They are now celebrating that the unemployment rate is now down to 19%, and that youth unemployment has gone down to about 48%. I don't view that as a great success.
Next question.
Sure. So the currency union has restricted one of the ways that prices can shift via the relative exchange rates. Thinking about the United States, one of the ways that we avoid this problem of needing to adjust wages is by the movement of people. You know, when Detroit has a bad year, people move out of Detroit, and the wages adjust accordingly in the union.
Does Detroit have some good years?
Yeah. Maybe in the next 5 or 10. So my question is that the United States has lacks one barrier that Europe doesn't, which is language. And I don't see that shifting anytime in the next 20, 30 years. Does that not seem like a permanent, insurmountable barrier to a successful currency union, or am I exaggerating?
So labor mobility is fairly high. I mean, labor mobility, and that's also research from Chicago here, actually in the US went down, and that the gap is not so big anymore between the US and in Europe. The other thing is, I think what the traditional models show, I think what they ignore is that if you actually move, and many Italians move to Germany and find work in Germany, Germany is huge. I mean, a million more than, I mean, the refugees came, but many people came to Germany. But of course, when you move from Italy to Germany, you walk away from your Italian debt. Okay, so that's in these initial models totally ignored. Anybody who is moving out of Italy or out of Greece is actually defaulting on its debt, and there will be few and few people then left to pay off the initial debt. So that's, I think, a big disadvantage from having this labor mobility. But
yeah, and that's another sort. In my book, I talk about different sources of divergence. And that is one of the sources of divergence. So as people in Greece leave, that means the debt per capita goes up. And so you get debt, but you're not obligated to pay it back by just moving to London. And so it means in particular that the most talented people in the, the labor mobility is higher among higher skilled people. So it's a system that has the effect of more skilled people leave Greece and Spain, and leaving the less skilled people behind to pay back the debts. And it becomes particularly outrageous when you realize that some of these debts were banking debts that the people who've left were responsible for undertaking.
Christian.
So a quick comment and then a question. So on the earlier discussion on the Greek debt bailout, it's often said that Germany and France were kind of aligned, but although it's difficult to get the numbers exactly straight, but it's often not known that the U.S. and the banks had an exposure that wasn't much smaller than the German exposure, and even the British had sort of about half of that exposure. The one country that clearly was off the charts was actually France, where I think the exposure was on the order of somewhere between 70 to 90 billion. And what's interesting, and this is sort of one of the things that I'm still working on, is that you could argue that the first bailout was indeed a transfer to France. And some of the countries that chipped in on that transfer were, among them was, for instance, Italy, which now is on the hook through the ECB share for some of the exposures. And Italy is a country that had a very little exposure in the prior to the first bailout. So that's just a comment. The question is the following. I share Marcus's optimism, and maybe it's because we're both German living in the U.S. and the optimism rubs off. But I think where it comes from is what Joe said at the beginning, that I think the whole project was a political project, and the political dividend is huge. And it's huge, especially for Germany, given its history and its role in Europe. But where I've become skeptical, and that's the question, is seeing the recent rise of populism. Until very recently, I would have said Germany will do whatever it takes to kind of keep the European project together because of the political reasons. And the Germans have always been among the staunchest defenders of this whole system, and I think even deep down into the population. But where I see the shifting, and this is where I'd be curious to sort of, both get your outside view and as well as Marcus's view, is how that's been changing recently, because that is something that I find deeply concerning.
Joe, you want to start?
Well, I think this issue of you might say populism all over Europe is one of the concerns that I have about the viability of the Eurozone. So when, you know, I was joking about the leaders of, the, you know, like the head of the ECOFIN saying, just give us time. The question is, will the politics, and particularly the populist movements, give you time? You know, you can't say, oh, you know, you've only had wages go, you've only had unemployment, youth unemployment of 40% for a decade, take another decade and we'll fix it. That's not likely to happen. And so my concern is that there's a clock ticking in a way, presented by the populist movements and separatist movements in some of the countries, but in any sense, a fragmentation of the center, you know, the center which held Europe together and was at the core of the success of the European project, that is fraying, and the disconnect between the speed at which the reforms are occurring and the disillusion with what is going on the part of large numbers of voters in these countries, exacerbated by some other things going on, migration, and which has not helped, means that I'm not sure there's going to be time to muddle through.
Markus, what do you think?
Yeah, I agree that its support is eroding for the whole European project, but it's, on the other hand, when you saw with the Brexit vote, the support for the Europe actually went up significantly in Germany and many other core countries, because suddenly people realized what they have by having Europe, the free movement, you can move around all across Europe as you want, you can live in any, you can work in any country within the European Union, and suddenly the popularity of the European Union actually went up. What one has to keep in mind, things can change very radically again. So imagine there's something happening on the East Front or something like this, and then suddenly people will realize much more that how important Europe is for the Europeans and also for the world as a whole. And I think things can shift very radically in short time frames. And you see it already now with Trump saying, oh, he will put less military defense into Europe. Now the Europeans have to stand up. There might be some fiscal expansion in Germany coming on the military side for this. And you will see things shifting around. But at the moment, we are at the critical juncture. And the mood is changing also in Germany to some extent, into a negative way. But I think there's still a very strong support to hold this thing together. And I think from outside, from the US perspective, they underestimate how strong these forces are. Because if you see the alternative would be much, much worse. And people don't see often this alternative. Of course, it's much harder to argue in this environment these days that rational economic reasoning prevails at the end of the day. But I think that's what makes me hopeful and confident things will hold together. And I think it will hold together.
So we're out of time. A telegraphic question and two telegraphic answers, please.
Okay. Well, Professor Stiglitz had sort of a colloquy with himself earlier in which he said, if you look at the United States as a common market, common currency, why does it work? And I think he said it's because there's sharing, willingness to share risk transfers in and out among the states. So one, did I get it right? And two, broader question, which has been alluded to, if that's the model, the United States as the European Union, the states as really countries, the federal government as the European Union. In other words, why does it work in the United States? You do have states, you do have federal government, you have a common currency. Doesn't work in the European Union. As you said, maybe you have to be less or more, either have to have a full-fledged constitution that has this unity of interest, or just make it more of a common market, not a union. That's the question.
Yeah, so I was using that a little bit as a metaphor, but helping to help understand that we do have a single currency working within 50 diverse states. One of the earlier questions pointed out one of the important aspects, which is free migration, that with a common language that clearly helps. There are many other institutional features that I didn't get into, but I think we would have run into a lot of problems if we didn't have common deposit insurance, if if we had a greater degree of diversity and we hadn't enabled our an economic system to bring our countries closer, our states closer together. And an example of where it is not working in the United States is Puerto Rico, which is admittedly a colony, so that it doesn't have the degree of discretion, but it is many of the symptoms of what you might call the dysfunction of a common currency with a legal framework that goes across too much diversity is causing a deep depression.
Actually, let me end with a statement that he made, which is very important, is the feeling of being European. In a sense, in America, people don't say we don't transfer money to Louisiana because they're lazy. In Europe, they I wouldn't comment on that, but in Europe, we do say that. And I think that that's part of the lack of a common European spirit. And paraphrasing General de Gaulle, who said it's very difficult to run a country that produces so many type of cheese. I say that the big difference is between the type of cheese. In the United States, there is only one type of cheese, that is cheddar cheese. With jalapeno, with whiskey, with this, that is always cheddar cheese. So it's easier to run a country with only one type of cheese. In Europe, there are so many different type of cheese that it's difficult to bring them together.
Even within France.
Even within France. Even within Sardinia. But with this, I want to thank you very much for participating, and thank the speaker.